So it's 4:30. I think we might begin. Welcome to the panel, The Internet and Global Labour. The most dominant shift for the last generation in the global labour pool came in the 90s with the breakup of the Soviet Union and Eastern Bloc countries entering the global economy, along with China's embracing of market capitalism and after India's market reforms to enter the global trading system. This has been referred to as the doubling or the great doubling of the global labour pool from 1.46 billion workers to 2.93. Some studies put the effective global labour force as having risen fourfold over the past two decades. The movement from farm to factory accelerated growth and productivity per capita GDP in China and other traditionally rural nations, involving their large labour forces in open market economies. Developed economies invested in labour-saving technologies and tapped global sources of low-cost labour. Some predictions put the global labour force is approaching 3.5 billion by 2030. Most of the additions will occur in India and the young developing economies of Africa and South Asia. And now, crowd labour is the most rapidly growing form. This generation's major shift has been the internet. Topical right now is the gig economy, enabled by the internet and smartphones, sometimes called the sharing economy, where companies seem to have emerged out of nowhere as digital middlemen, facilitating commercial actions on internet platforms, Airbnb, offshoots from Amazon, such as Amazon Mechanical Turk, Uber, etc., with many questions. Are they employers or are they just facilitators, with many of the risks and costs being borne by the worker and with no benefits or job protection? Out of this same internet-facilitated new world of global labour came click worker in Germany, full factory in France, cloud crowd, crowd flower, and others, the most dominant and controversial of which has been the aforementioned Amazon Mechanical Turk, AMT. One of these many platforms where crowd-based labour is bought and sold, most humans performing short tasks or hits that computers are incapable of doing, such as reading numbers from buildings, text from photographs, verifying addresses, or recognizing irony or humor in articles or narrative, but many more, many simple, and some quite complex tasks. It is infamously difficult to ascertain the most basic information about crowd workers and their conditions without significant field work, and two of our panelists have done extensive research in this area. The mysteries surrounding crowd work statistics are perhaps best embodied by AMT, an early Jeff project, as it was known, beginning in 2005. The term Mechanical Turk on one level might seem rather offensive, conjuring ideas of white Western appropriation of non-Western or others' physical strength. It was, though, an amazingly effective 18th century hoax, a chess-playing machine commissioned by the Empress Maria Theresa in the early days of the Industrial Revolution, an automaton in Oriental garb, Western ideas of the stereotypical Turk, akin to the turbaned figure in the Tom Hanks movie Big, in the old penny arcade box. This figure referenced and played upon Western ideas of Eastern mystique for the purposes of deception to other Westerners. The machine concealed a human chess master making the real moves and undoubtedly sitting for many hours in quite constrained and uncomfortable conditions. AMT is equally shrouded in mystery, though we do know it is a digital platform behind which there are actual humans working at computer screens, competing with thousands of other workers for short micro-tasks, paying very little money, and like the chess master behind the hoax, undoubtedly sitting for many hours in quite constrained and uncomfortable conditions. But perhaps being paid significantly less, and some say for as little as $2 an hour. The ultimate free market capitalist Western company, Amazon, with all its baggage about fulfillment center working conditions and worker monitoring, choosing to co-opt Mechanical Turk trope, the trope of the mysterious figure from the East, has another extended geographical significance, as today platforms such as AMT, by their existence and function, are collapsing geographic boundaries and shifting traditional notions of worker competition between continents. Distinctions from the digital Global North and Digital Global South are falling away in the realm of crowd labour, with workers from younger and older economies perhaps competing on a more level playing field. But is this movement a shift towards more equitable global economies overall, or is it a race to the bottom where Turkers or Taskers, as some of these workers are known, compete for hicks at ever lower rates, and the requesters, the employers, can only be held to account by third-party apps, naming and shaming them. Employers, be they human or computer programs, who have posted micro-jobs, accepted workers, but refuse to pay for completed work they might arbitrarily deem unacceptable. Recourses, worker organizing, class action lawsuits, and very interesting ensuing test cases have all become a dominant part of the discussion concerning crowd laborers and their need for rights and protections. Two of our panelists are going to be looking into this area and sharing with us valuable research and insights, suggesting recourses for laborers with few rights and little representation. Mark Graham is our first panelist, and he is professor of internet geography at the Oxford Internet Institute and a faculty fellow at the Alan Turing Institute at the British Library, and also a visiting fellow at the Department of Media and Communications at the London School of Economics. His research includes economic geography, digital labour, critical data studies, development, cities and digital divides. He's the author with William H. Dutton of Society and the Internet, How Networks of Information and Communication Are Changing Our Lives. Mark Graham is going to give us an overview of digital labour. Mark.
Thanks. Okay, thanks very much to the organisers for having me here today. It's really nice to have been involved. What I do in my research is I study how changing geographies are reconfiguring our world of work and what changing geographies ultimately mean for some of the millions of workers in developing countries that are being enrolled into new global networks and markets that are being formed. Now, these changing geographies that I'm referring to, they come at the confluence of three stories. So first of all, the idea that the world is increasingly defined by labor surplus. Every year, we get 46 million new workers joining the world's labor force. The second story is one about changing connectivity. So we now have 3.5 billion people connected to the internet. 10 years ago, less than 8% of people in low-income countries were connected to the internet. Today, it's over a third. The third story is the evolution of an older story of outsourcing. We're not talking about the ways that organizations have been outsourcing to other organizations over the last few decades, but something a bit different. All of these platforms and work marketplaces that have been constructed to allow people to relatively easily buy and sell labor, supposedly in a somewhat unmediated way. Today, there are 48 million workers globally registered with these online labor platforms. Now, what sorts of things are these people doing? Some of it is doing things like playing games to create items of value and then selling those items. So here's an example of a game account that's available on eBay. It can be workers being paid to like pages on Facebook or YouTube or Instagram, retweet things on Twitter. It can be so-called human intelligence tasks on a platform like Amazon's Mechanical Turk. Here's an example of a job listing on Mechanical Turk. This is for someone to write a fake Yelp review for a gardening business. If you've ever seen a Yelp review, there's a chance that it was created in this way. But most of the work instead looks a bit like this. This is Upwork.com. On this marketplace, clients list a whole range of jobs, things like web development, software development, writing, graphic design, and then workers bid on those tasks. Now, because of the confluence of these three factors that I mentioned, unemployment, changing connectivity, and the availability of all of this work, there are a lot of people that are talking about these potentials of digital labor to positively change the lives of people in low-income countries. So we had, for instance, the executive director of the Philippine government's ICT office. This is him running dozens of roadshows around the country in which they were encouraging people to sign up for these online work platforms. These initiatives were run all over the country. Tens of thousands of people attended these things. Nigeria's government has a similar program called Microwork for Jobs Creation. And I took this picture in Kenya, where workers are taught how to transcribe short snippets of text to do similar work. Now, what unites all of these things is a vision that not only are new types of jobs available, but that essentially new economic geographies exist. The global market for this digital work is, as the CEO of one of the world's largest marketplace puts it, frictionless. So maybe some of this vision has come about because of the fact that work has historically always been quite geographically bounded. So as the economic geographer David Harvey famously noted, workers are unavoidably place-based because labor power has to go home every night. Now, this mattered because the global reach of capital often came at the cost of place-bound labor. But the rise of all of this digital work maybe means that not just capital, but also labor can now compete in this global market. Now, this was all a very long way of introducing the fact that in the context of online labor markets, my colleagues Vili Lerumvita, Helena Barnard, and Alex Wood, and myself, we've been studying what geography still means, where it still matters, who benefits from these warpings of time and space, and specifically what the spatial and fixing of work means for the workers in some of the world's economic margins. We've been asking who it is that performs a lot of this digital work that's carried out today, and we've been reflecting some of the key benefits and costs that are associated with these new digital regimes of work. The way that we've done all of this is with a combination of data sources, so specifically quantitative transaction data from the world's largest online work marketplace, Odesk, that's now been renamed Upwork. We've done 150 interviews as well with workers in Southeast Asia and Sub-Saharan Africa in six countries, and we've also done a survey with a few hundred more, about 450, I think. Now, it's all work that's ongoing. There's still a lot that I could talk about here, but what I specifically want to do in the time that I have is focus on four widely theorized changes that digital work could bring about, and that's improved worker bargaining power, disintermediated value chains, skills upgrading, and economic inclusion. Now, one of the main potentials of online work in the context of economic development, again, is skills arbitrage. So in most local labor markets, workers who have a certain skill set, they only have a handful of viable employers, and this can give employers a great deal of market power. This is where these online labor markets come in. In theory, they delocalize this work so that there are fewer geographic constraints on where it can be done. Now, the first thing to point out here, though, is that there seems to be a huge imbalance in the supply and the demand of this work. On Upwork.com, again, the world's biggest marketplace, there's 9 million registered workers and only 4 million registered clients. If we look at data from last month, September 2016, there's a really noteworthy geography of supply and demand. Almost all of the demand for digital work, so this is where the employers are, comes from a handful of countries in the global north, plus India. But the workers are from all over the place, rich countries and poor countries all competing in the same market. So basically, demand is geographically concentrated, but supply is geographically diffuse. And we can see that if we look at the hours that are worked by workers in different countries. I won't explain this chart in detail, but basically the data show that workers all over the world, they often align their work patterns to be in sync with clients in Western Europe and North America. So in fact, 57% of workers told us that they lose sleep as a result of this work. Only 23% of workers told us they don't lose sleep as a result of this work. These geographic imbalances, they beg questions of how these digital workers experience their own bargaining position then. And basically, clear narratives of a race to the bottom emerged from a lot of these interviews. So workers tend to have quite stringent conditions that are imposed on them. So for instance, on Upwork, I'm not sure if you're familiar with this, but screenshots can be taken every 10 minutes of your computer to make sure that the workers are doing what they say they're doing. And there were just loads of examples of online workers who really felt quite powerless to negotiate conditions and rates for their labor. They vividly experienced a perceived oversupply of labor power on these platforms, and so they can't charge what they feel are fair rates. 45% of workers we spoke to, they said they felt they were easily replaceable. Only 26% of people disagreed with that. And this is important because most informants had very limited social security, and this presents both a risk to their health and their income if they were to lose work. Okay, second, value chain reconfigurations. Another theme we explored in our data is the question of whether online work is reconfiguring service value chains. A lot of people thought that digital work would allow for more geographic bridging and disintermediation. Now, the issue is that this doesn't take into account the very heavy role that reputational capital plays on these platforms. So if you have very good feedback score as a worker, you'll get a lot of work. But we spoke to loads of workers who said that it took them years and years to get their first job because they didn't have any feedback. Because of that, we actually saw a lot of this going on. Some of those with the best scores, they hire other workers on the platform to carry out the work for them, often under very unfavorable conditions. So we spoke to one worker, for instance, who applied for this job in the middle called write an article about tailor-made suits. The listed suggestion for this piece of work was $50. She bid $15 on it, or that person bid $15 on it. But then this job ultimately went to another contractor. This contractor had a very high positive feedback score and requested a price of $23. This person got the job, but then offered it to the person that we spoke to for just $3.50. And she did it because she did it because she needed the work, but not without feeling that the whole situation was just inherently unfair. And that probably helps to contribute to the significant income inequality that we see on these platforms. This is a graph that shows with our odesk.com data, about 80% of the workers make about 10% of the income. Third thing I want to talk about is skills upgrading. So in some cases, we saw functional upgrading and a movement towards higher value work, but a lot of workers were really kept at an arm's length. A lot of workers, they just didn't know who they were working for or what purpose or function their labor served. And this made it extremely hard for them to upgrade. And finally, economic inclusion. So we heard some cases of workers transcending local labor market discrimination, but there were equally examples of exclusion being explicitly and more subtly expressed. So this is, I'm not sure if you can read what that says there, it's one of the more obvious ones where a client tells workers from South Asia to not even bother bidding on a job. Now, to wrap this all up, these online marketplaces, they've undoubtedly helped a lot of people find work and income and autonomy and flexibility, things they wouldn't have had otherwise, perhaps. But there are also important problems. There is no open, frictionless market that all workers can compete equally in. These dispersed geographies continue to exist, and they're often used against an atomized workforce. Many workers then have jobs that are characterized by long and irregular hours, intense work, low income, and tedium. These opaque production networks that we see, they conceal exploitative work practices where it exists from end customers and end clients. A lack of co-presence and an international labor pool of digital workers, that makes it quite hard to both organize place-based struggles for worker rights and enact solidarity with fellow workers on the other side of the planet. And the ownership and the control of these labor marketplaces in just a few unaccountable hands means that work tends to be performed outside of the purview of national governments. Things like minimum wages, worker protections, and even taxes seem to be optional rather than required for both the platforms and the clients that source work through them. So we basically see the clear emergence of what Guy Standing refers to as the precariat, a class of people who lack any of these seven forms of labor-related security. This is maybe not a problem for those who thrive in the system, but for everyone else, this lack of security and the structural transfer of risk and responsibility is far more troubling. So clients absolve themselves of it, the platforms absolve themselves of it, and the workers, and in some cases the states, are left as the ones to carry all of this risk. But I think this is just one vision for the internet and for digital work, and I worry that it's based on quite a misguided vision of what the internet itself is. So if we see the internet as bringing into being a separate space in which, according to John Perry Barlow's famous Declaration of the Independence of Cyberspace, states, and I quote him here, have no sovereignty where we gather, and all actors are able to equally participate in a global marketplace, then we might actually see no alternatives to these current configurations of digital labor. We might see online work marketplaces and practices as not just unregulated, but unregulatable. But the internet, of course, doesn't exist in some sort of alternate sphere. It's always spatially grounded in people and in institutions. And that's where I want to end, with a few reflections on what I think is needed to rethink what alternate futures for what digital work might look like. So, first of all, we could imagine a market-based approach in which strategies of consumer watchdogs, certification schemes, and activist organizations could be emulated. So a lot of exploitative digital work, it probably happens because end users don't really know much about upstream work practices. So we could imagine organizations committed to transparency and identifying best practices, doing a lot to ensure that workers are paid living wages, they have appropriate social and economic protections, and that they just aren't saddled with an undue amount of risk. So basically a fair work foundation instead of a fair trade foundation. A second, labor rights strategy. So traditional unions, they relied on proximity to build a sense of mutuality amongst workers. Place mattered to them. Now, a seeming paradox of the digital age is that by connecting people and reducing distance, they also seem to be reducing shared empathy amongst workers. There's a real understanding amongst workers that if they withdraw their labor, then workers in other parts of the world are able to quickly replace them. So marketplaces are also designed to always remind workers that they're precisely that, a market, and one in which workers from all over the world are supposed to compete with one another. So what could be done then? Well, first of all, because the atomized nature of this work acts against the interests of most workers, we should be thinking about ways to build their collective power. So these are potentially fruitful conditions for the creation of some sort of transnational digital workers union or trade secretariat. If we lack the physical proximity that unions traditionally needed, we at least need some sort of shared occupational identity. The issue, though, is that there's competing worker identities at play here. Some see themselves as doing digital work that's just temporary. Some see it as a springboard for their larger career. Some see it as full-time work, some as part-time work. Some see themselves as entrepreneurs. Some see themselves as workers. So one explicit role for digital workers, for a digital workers union, could be building a sort of class consciousness, highlighting the precariousness of this work, and actually building on Gina Neff's work so that this so-called, what she calls venture labor, that I'll quote her here, the explicit expression of entrepreneurial values by non-entrepreneurs, so that this does not become the norm. That workers recognize that they're receiving a lot of the risks of entrepreneurship, but very few of the rewards. How do we construct occupational identities in this very ephemeral world of work? Well, maybe one strategy could be to try to unite all of these groups under a general umbrella identity of digital workers, point to their commonalities, point to their shared interests. But a second strategy could be to do the exact opposite, not privilege the digital as the unit of analysis. Look to the commonalities between occupations like transcribers, translators, programmers, designers, and so on. All of this stuff just happens to be done through the internet, but it's within those occupational groups that identities could be formed. So in any case, in this global market for work, what we see is that there's no way to do any of this without a truly global and transnational response anymore. Now, a second strategy we've seen has been the inaction of what you might call digital spaces of resistance. So digital workers already make quite extensive use of digital affordances, like Facebook groups and subreddits, in order to coordinate and share complaints and share work opportunities, give feedback to one another. So here's one interesting initiative, for instance, put together by the German union IG Metall, where workers rate platforms in order to highlight problematic practices on them. And this bringing together of digital workers then opens up creative potentials for what you might think of as digital picket lines that could potentially barricade the digital presences of firms in order to have the sort of disruptive effects the physical picket lines have. Regulatory strategies. So the geographically dispersed nature of these digital work marketplaces, it's made them extremely hard to regulate. And we get situations like this one, where the marketplace boasts that contracts can be ended at any time. This is a quote, a literal quote from their website. So my colleague Alex Wood and I, what we did is we took some advice from employment lawyers in the UK, and they claim, at least in the UK, that employment status needs to be established in the place that a service is actually provided. And this brings us back to geography. Where is a service provided? If a worker is in one country, a client's in another country, the computer server on which the work is being done is in a third. Whatever the answer is, let's remember what I mentioned in the beginning of this talk, that only a few countries are home to the vast majority of clients. Let's think about those handful of countries as strategic bottlenecks of a sort. So my understanding is that Germany already has some form of this, whereby the end client is responsible that a minimum wage is paid throughout the supply chain. But let's think about this sort of strategic bottleneck at a global scale. It's in those strategic bottlenecks that we can think about doing things like enforcing minimum standards. Why should an employer that's based in somewhere like Germany or the UK or Norway be able to avoid adhering to local labor laws and minimum standards just because they use the digital platform to connect with a worker? And finally, these digital work marketplaces, they extract rents from every transaction, and they design their digital context, obviously, to provide some kinds of affordances and not others. So, for instance, they generally heighten a sense of competition amongst workers by making workers look at each other's bids and rates. So a lot of workers told us stories like this one. They were disheartened by the scope and the scale of competition, or at least the perceived scope and scale of competition that surrounded them. So we could then maybe reconsider who actually owns the digital means of production here. Especially in the US, we're seeing a growing movement to create and work with cooperatively owned digital platforms, all of them asking what greater democratic control over the production and over the utilization of the surplus should look like. So to sum this all up, I think it's worth remembering, again, that there are now 3.5 billion people on the internet, most of whom live in low-wage economies, many of whom are now able to compete with anyone, anywhere for digital jobs. At the moment, the millions of workers who do this sort of digital work, they do so in a largely unregulated way, and this clearly benefits some workers, but we should also worry about a race to the bottom, especially as tens of millions of new internet users join the global network every year. Now, we can never go back to a pre-globalized world of work, but this doesn't necessarily mean that we should be satisfied with a digital Wild West in which these atomized workers are left to fend for themselves. As these transnational, digitally exchanged work, as all of this becomes ever more common, I think we can change our expectations, and we can use what we now know about these economic geographies of digital work to envision, and I think hopefully strive towards, alternate futures. So the place I'd like to end is by saying that instead of imagining all of this digital work as being undertaken in digital spaces, somehow beyond the realm of regulation, let's always remember that it happens somewhere. This digital work always has a geography. Thanks.
Our second panelist is Neha Gupta, a PhD candidate from the University of Nottingham, who approaches the subject of crowd workers as an ethnographer. Neha Gupta is an author with David Martin, Jackie O'Neill, and Benjamin V. Hanrahan of Turking in a Global Market in the Journal of Computer-Supported Cooperative Work. She'll be speaking from these papers, Turking Life in India, Understanding Indian Crowd Workers, about Indian workers on AMT, Being a Turker, about the American workers on AMT, and Turking in a Global Labor Market, a comparative paper on Indian and American workers. The principal researcher, David Martin, from Xerox Research, XRCE, who was studying coordinating with the American workers, Christy Milland, and other researchers in the US, Six Silberman and his team, passed away suddenly this summer. He was her mentor, and he cared deeply about the subject of ethics in crowd work and fairness for crowd workers.
Hello, everyone. I had a real urge to say, after Mark finished, what he said, because I cover a lot of similar topics, but the primary interest for my work was Mechanical Turk. So the one question I get asked is, why did you decide to do research on Mechanical Turk? Why study, you know, crowd work and crowd workers? So I would give some background on, you know, what was interesting for me when I started doing the PhD. So there was quite a lot of literature about crowd work and crowd workers in the academic literature, in terms of getting better quality work out of people who use these platforms. And there was some literature in advocacy and employment journals, government organizations, so the ILO, the National Employment Rights Project, the World Bank, article, and there were quite a few journalism pieces, you know, the ones of the sort, oh, I became a Turker for one day, how the hell does somebody do it? You know, those kind of pieces. And then we found out that there are quite a few researchers in the US who are doing surveys on figuring out who the workers are, what is the, you know, general demographics. In 2010, when we were interested in the subject for the first time, we found that there was 46% of American Turkers and 34% Indian Turkers, and we thought, wow, we would like to study what the Indian scenario, what the Indian side of the story is. And so we decided to look at, you know, the qualitative side of things, and we found out that there are quite a few problems in terms of slow payment, low pay, lack of communication, and all this just by looking at the forums that these workers use, and they communicate online. So we wondered what it would be like on the ground if we actually go speak to people, meet them in real time, and see what they do. So our approach was from a very HCI, CSEW perspective. We come from a long tradition of doing workplace studies. I was partially sponsored by Xerox, so I had, you know, that tradition. And we wanted to see if we can design something or study design that is already existing in this space to provide better information for the workers, provide better tools, and, you know, empower them in some way with design. So what did we do? I did an ethnographic study of Indian workers. I set up a shop in India for about 6 months. I did interviews with them. I did 35 interviews, and I observed 12 people doing work from their homes, offices, wherever they let me through the door. My supervisor from Xerox was studying, Dave Martin, was studying the American workers, and he was coordinating with Kristin Braa, you know, Six Silverman, and others who were doing research on the American side. So I want to tell the Indian side of the story here first. Introducing Nagin, the person who is standing right in the end, this guy. So he got a civil engineering diploma in the 1960s, and he's at a lower end of the spectrum of the workers that we spoke to in India. So his regional language is somewhere between Tamil and Malayalam and a mix of another South Indian language, and it's really hard to understand what he says. But yeah, so he lives at the southernmost tip of India, near Kanyakumari, and this is his shop. So it's a DTP shop. It has printers, scanners, photocopying machines, and this place actually serves as a mini hub for crowdsourcing in that area, which was quite surprising because we didn't expect going into the field to find physical social collaboration, because we came in with the idea that, oh, it's an atomized work, people are working in isolation, nobody knows anybody else, and we go there and we find a bunch of friends. So this is his shop. He runs the shop during the day, and when the business is slow, he sits on one of the computers that's there and opens his Mechanical Turk account and starts working. This shop has really good, strong internet connection. And this is one of the places where his friends come over to sit and work on Mechanical Turk, because he's got a good router as well. So two or three people can sit and work on their laptop at the same time. Nagin has not a very good understanding of English, so he can do transactional things on the internet. So if you ask him, click on the button, he would do it. But if you give him a more complex instruction, which requires a deeper knowledge of English, that would be difficult for him. So he uses his family, he's got a teenage son, and other people who have better knowledge of English to come and teach him what the instruction means. So, for example, he likes doing transcription tasks or form filling. So somebody would come and sit next to him and tell him what the instructions mean, and they will practice it with him a couple of times till he says, okay, I think I'm good and I can deal with it, you know, myself. And then he does it on his own. There's something of a quid pro quo, you know, in there. So somebody else teaches him how to use or how to work on a particular task, and he lets them use the internet for free. Otherwise, you need to pay for using one of the computers or using the internet that's there. So this guy is at one of the lower ends of the spectrum. She's Nidhi. She's a master's student. She lives in Hyderabad. It's one of the tech cities in India. And it's well connected with good infrastructure, technology-wise. She has her own laptop. She uses mobile data. And she's working for one of the multinational banks that are based in the city. So she goes for work in the morning, and she loves writing. She uses Mechanical Turk to practice her skill of writing. So it wasn't an income generator for her. She didn't care about the money. She cared about getting more practice for her writing work. So she would do articles, reviews, or whatever needed her to write and be creative. And what I wanted to show here is that there is a huge variance in skill and in terms of infrastructure and expectations. So for Nagin, it was very important that money came first for him. So he wanted to make an income out of working on these platforms. And although his infrastructure wasn't that great and he was employed, he really cared about being able to work on Mechanical Turk. Whereas for Nidhi, she had a job and she wasn't dependent on Mechanical Turk for money. And she was more exposed to the Western media. She understands cultural differences. She studied in English and had a working and a deeper understanding of the language. So we've been asked this question time and again, so why do people work? And so we thought, you know, let's ask the people, why do you work? So the primary reason we were given was that they work for money. That is, you know, it's supposed to be common sense that if you go on a platform which allows you to make money, then you are there to make money. They also wanted to be employed, and at the same time, kill time or make supplementary income if they had something else to do, if they were a student or if they already had a full-time job. At the same time, working after a number of weeks, months, they found different avenues of, you know, development, so professional development. They were able to develop competence in certain skills, and they found that they were learning new things about different cultures. They were testing apps and they were playing games, you know, massive multiplayer games. So it had all these different avenues for them to, you know, enjoy. At the same time, it wasn't, well, the primary motivation still remained earning money. So we see this entertainment as job satisfaction, similar to what a conventional job would, you know, give an employee. But there was a compromise. So there was this was a compromise from, you know, in terms of flexibility, in terms of what was better. Is it better to go out and work in a traditional job where you're spending 3 hours on commute and you're paying You know, you're paying for petrol, you're paying for getting to work, and you're paying for the stress of staying outside. So it was a compromise on flexibility, accessibility of work, the social nature of conventional jobs, and, you know, income, primarily. So Mark touched upon this, the availability of work. The one thing we found on Mechanical Turk, which was a key factor in sustaining the workers, is being able to sit there for hours together or knowing the best way to find the work that you want to do. So here's a quote from a professional worker who works almost every day and earns a good income. He says, you cannot find much work during the day. And he gives a timetable of what he does. And he says, I do most of the work at 7:30 p.m., sometimes till 1, 2, 3. If I got more work in the morning, I'm willing to sit and work all day. So what this shows is, although the work is seen as flexible, the workers don't realize that they are organizing their life around this work. And they're willing to sacrifice in terms of time and effort in looking for work that is preferable for them to do. Then there is another notion in the articles that we found in the Western media, that Turking is for fun. So people have a great time doing form-filling exercises. And we inquired that. So these are American workers who say that attitude would be a request is dream come true. And if nothing else, it's just for the cash. And this is not the right attitude. The expectations vary. I will show you. So there is a considerable difference in the wages, of course. And this also sets the expectations of workers. So in the US, we found out that the highest earners, which are only a handful of people, earn between $15,000 to $16,000 per year, which is the bare minimum in the US. In India, the highest earners were earning about $8,000 to $10,000 a year. Again, a handful of people. But that was pretty good to support a family of five or six. And the low income, the low earnings in India were highly variant, so they could vary between $250 a year to $500 a year, meaning $5 to $10 per week, depending on how much time they were able to spend on doing this sort of work. So depending on if you were doing full-time professional work, people were spending anywhere between 80 to 115 hours a week, so literally just sitting there in front of a computer and being there online, looking for work, doing the work, versus people who were doing part-time sporadic work who worked 5 to 10 hours a week. So we saw people, we saw one professional worker who literally sat there and did the work as soon as he woke up. Then his wife would come and get him tea, take the cup away after a few minutes, then bring breakfast and then take that away, and then bring kids to say, these are your kids, play with them for some time. And then she'll take them away. So literally the guy just sat there and the family helped him with being able to sit there and work all the time. So I want to talk about this and end my presentation. So the attitude towards crowd work, the difference between the American and the Indian workers was very apparent on this platform, because although it's supposed to be global, it brings the Indian workers face to face with the American workers, and the competition is very fierce. And you can see that if you go through the forums and the posts that are there online. So the attitude towards crowd work is more positive in the West, more positive in India, and it is seen as a window into different cultures. It, in a way, highlights the digital divide, versus the digital empowerment. So people who are living in cities, for example, students working from Bangalore or Pune, had better infrastructure, knew better, had better skills, so they were doing better quality work. So they were working on codes and writing assignments. The people who are living outside the cities had lower skills, so they were doing form-filling tasks, which paid them 10 cents. The job, because it involved working on a computer, was seen as a white-collar job because, you know, you were not picking up bricks and working in a construction industry. And but the uncertainty and the issues with finding work every day was seen as blue-collar. So it's paradoxical, in a way, the white-collar, blue-collar thing. And in a sense, the Mechanical Turk work made people feel that there was dignity in the work they were doing because they were American clients who were willing to take the work that they were providing, and they were paying them in dollars. And it was Amazon, you know, the brand, and it was supposed to be legitimate work. Who the workers were helping somebody else in the U.S. do something reasonable and contributing to a different economy. So, yes, that's my presentation. Thank you.
Crowdworker platforms are one dominant aspect of changes to the global labor pool in the internet age, and so is the leap to smart mobile in younger economies and what that might mean for global labor, consumers and clients. It's opened up many communities to greater healthcare information and access as the digital divide between younger and older economies decreases. And with the jump to mobile in the global south, IT has had a major impact on information systems' ability to transform people's access to healthcare, education, and also information facilitating the exchanges between professionals, such as doctors and their patients. Our final panelist is Dr. Kristin Braa, who is professor at the Department of Informatics at the University of Oslo. She is the author, with Petter Nielsen and Olha Hodne, Titlestad, of Innovation for Healthcare in Developing Countries in Medical Technology in Meeting Tomorrow's Healthcare Challenges. Kristin.
Okay, so I'm very, very interested in the two last presentations because I don't really know much about crowd working. But what I would like to tell you about today is actually very much following up on Kalle Moane's presentation of the Nordic model, which we in our world call the Scandinavian model, to systems design, information systems design, participatory design in a way. And I will have a kind of a global labor perspective on it. And I actually talked to a lot of my colleagues in this global community about what we think about global labor after working with this project for many years. This project is a kind of an interesting, maybe, example of how the Scandinavian sort of break some traditions and become a movement and very much attaching to the social economy that you all can share, you can benefit, but you also have to give. I just want to see, we talk about that 3.5 billion people have access to internet. Most of them have access through a mobile phone, or at least mobile internet, because the fixed net is not very apparent in the rural Africa, nor the rural Asia. Just to have a glance, I won't go into detail, but if we take the case of India, which is we just heard about now, it's a very extreme case because the growth in India was so very, very high. And you can see the steep growth of mobile phones. when the internet use is not the same, and almost all the users, or at least 75-80% of the users, access the internet through mobile phones. And I really think that to leverage that fact that the whole world are now connected is actually a very positive stance. So I would like, instead of many of them very negative, maybe that's a Scandinavian way or Nordic, Norwegian way, to have a very positive experience through our project, how we have been able to enable and leverage upon this mobile revolution going on in the global south, and to create sustainable capacity building project that enable a lot of jobs and a lot of careers and new institutions. This HISP project district that are responsible for the open source software platform, and as mentioned earlier, the importance of doing data analytics is actually a data warehouse for data analytics for decision making within public health. It started off as a PhD project in South Africa in a collaboration with Western Cape, funded by NORAD, collaborating with the Ministry of Health after apartheid in 94, to make a system to decentralize the health system in South Africa. They had 14 different Ministry of Health due to ethnicity and where they were rural or in a township or in towns. That was the start. So it traveled through Africa, but it also to the rest of the world, but it also traveled to technologies. So in the beginning, action research project that did action and implementation in the local with local instances on proprietary software. And when in 2005 the web-based technology came, we changed the platform to be web-based. And from 2011 on, all the countries are online using cloud-based services and mobile internet. And the first sub-Saharan African e-government system was based on this platform in 2011 and inspired the whole continent. So now that's standard. We are today in 50 countries, and it's an integrated data warehouse. And the slogan came already from the 94, information for action, empowering the health worker with being informed. Not only sending the data up, but getting analytics back in order to improve the health services. So this platform is generic and generative, as we call it, and it supports a wide range of health sectors, but mostly up to now health sector, but also education and forestry and others. When people know the capacity of that platform, they can serve other means as well. But it allows for distributing innovation in a wide network with all these people. And it will, and we can have apps on top that will not disturb the underneath. Here's just a map over all the countries that are now using it. That's why we call it a movement, because it started off with very few countries, and it's now, after the mobile internet, we could say that this growth from one district, and now if we talk about one district here in Western Cape, and now 60 countries, and it's 100% unique users, but 1 billion people are covered by this health information system, which is public health, I have to tell that. It's mother and child health, it's disease surveillance platform, it's HIV surveillance, it's TB, malaria, and so forth. And we are collaborating with all the global agencies. So 300 people have, through these years, are working within the HISP. In Africa and Asia. But also, in addition, we do a lot of training for in-country innovation. For instance, we have trained youngsters to be in Work Without Borders to app development in Gaza. So they can, because they're not allowed out, so they can support a neighboring country in the Arabic region. So that's just for fun, showing the growth of the DHS2 impact and implementation. And see the correlation with the fiber coming to Africa. When the fiber coming to Africa, you have a stable, fixed internet, which you can have mobile internet upon. So that was a huge revolution in order to be able to cover the whole country. So why action what is action research here? Yes, we do research with PhD students locally, recruited, but take their degree in Oslo. But we do research on the ground, solving a specific problem, make it general and implement it in the platform, and the new release, it will benefit all the 60 other countries. So our vision is to develop sustainable information systems that empower communities, but also health workers and decision makers to improve coverage and quality of service. For instance, an example from 2011, where we understood that the mobile internet in Kenya was so good, the whole software team, together with the PhD student, spent many months in Kenya to solve a national implementation there. By accident, understood that fixed internet was much worse than the mobile. So it was decided and redesigned the system to go on mobile internet, cloud-based server hosting, and it was able in 11 months to scale to the whole country. So the rural areas on the border in Somalia and in the whole Kenya was then suddenly able to see their own data and have communication with others. Because this platform is also a social media. So you can do discussional interpretations, discussional analytics if you are alone in your own rural facility. We stress that we strengthen national health information systems. We are collaborating with a lot of global donors, but we are supported by NORAD, and we usually say that in our Scandinavian tradition, we need to build institutions, so we work with ministries. So the first thing we do is to train ministries, and many of our PhD students is actually coming from the ministries. So what we do is we build knowledge on implementation, while we actually build systems on the ground, and that's how we can have kind of very, very valuable knowledge on how to make it work, how to make robust systems on the ground. So far, 45 PhD students have been graduated through this program, and these are still in the network, and they are in the country, in the region, and form region node that support the neighboring countries. In addition, we have at least, we cannot really count, graduated 400 master students through international master programs that still runs. We got UD Norwegian money to make this master program, but it still got institutionalized and it's still there. Now we don't have any money, so now we cheat and we leverage on the very good dollar currency rate to still have scholarships. But there is no money for scholarships anymore. But we continue our pace with some donors. So this network of action, we call it, is actually to enable that, you know, when you have over a critical mass and people get benefit from being part of the network, they can have an education. So I usually say it's 20 years of capacity building. That's the thing, believing in people. But it's also, when I was talking about global labor, it's a lot of global labor because we have all these HISP teams formed bottom up. Everybody will be part of the family because it's open source, we share everything, and we give people a future and a dream about the future and also an aspiration. Because we have these academies, in the beginning it was a training and sharing of best practice in these regional academies. But that has, in the beginning, Oslo was doing it. But then the first guys we trained are now trainers. And then he formed his nodes. So now they are doing all the training in these regional nodes. And that's kind of twice a year in each of these regions. And also in addition in countries. So that are becoming the engine of this spreading of this innovation. Then I ask, so how many jobs have we actually created through this network? But then we start over, we have always done, but no more institutionalized, building capacity at scale, meaning collaborating with universities, and universities getting roles by USAID and other donors to be the training capacity. And then they have new departments and they hire people. And we also, of course, we train the undergraduate students in data use, how to go from data to information to action. Actionable data. That's it. What it's all about. That the data shall not only be collected, and that's a very, very, very hierarchical, silo, bureaucratic. You just send the data up, and you might see the same data 2 years after in the yearbook, if it's ever happened to come to the national, your data coming to the national. So instead, you can be online, and you can see your data, and that's actually a very empowering feature. Because from being very low skilled, you're becoming more skilled, you're actually providing data to the global good. And you can get feedback, and you can improve on yourself. You can better yourself, which is a very, very highly valued feature and value for people. So what we see is actually that we have raised the social status. I had a long discussion with my people from Kenya, from Mali, in the whole West Africa, and the Tanzania. What is actually the benefit you see in your countries? And that is say that people are now much more proud of the job, and they don't quit the job. And of course, in addition to, so they stay in the job. So what we see is, this is my last slide. What we see that we utilize whatever the technology exists and deliver different services, whether it's on the laptop or a tablet or only SMS only, on Nokia phones, on smartphones, and Android is there to stay. But for instance, in Zambia, we cannot use Android at all, because in the rural villages, there is no electricity, and it's very, very dangerous to have a smartphone, because you will be mugged. But then we use, in fact, Nokia phones, Java-enabled Nokia phones and apps on that. So my mission here today is to think that if we are thinking open source, if we are thinking new about the new economy, look into the potential of having cross-cutting networked project. This is an action research project, and it's actually coming out of the iron and metal union project that Kalle Moane was talking about. That tradition of actually working on the ground and learning by doing and involving people and grassroots, and then it spread. So I think we should rethink our research project to be more participatory and involve the people. And I think the potential of the mobile technology we haven't seen yet, but we really should work hard on utilizing it. Although we have problems, but it's a little bit Western problem to be so concerned about privacy and being looked upon. People are very happy to be online, to be informed. And so it's a little Western rhetorics, at least in the morning. So I think that's a very, very different from what we see from Asia and Africa. So I'm stopping here. So happy to continue the discussion in the panel.
Thank you all for very interesting and different presentations. We had with Kristin an example of the Nordic model, correct? The ground up organizing, and also with Mark, we had some potential solutions for labor abuses. And then with Neha, it was very refreshing to see the actual people behind these online profiles, and to get an idea that these are actually real people we're talking about, and real issues. So I'd like to start by asking you both what you saw in Kristin's presentation that gave you pause for thought and potential solutions that you could see in crossover between the two.
Two things, really. So one was the technological infrastructure, and second was the participatory research. I think there is a strong culture of social nature, which is basically you don't think of people as individuals. It's a society. So when you're building something or you're doing some research, you're not looking at a person or something that's, you know, one-to-one in nature. It's about understanding a phenomena as a social process, which is collaborative. And so when you build tools or when you're starting a movement, it's not an individual thing. It's, you know, collaborative, it's group work, it's meant to be seen that way. And it's the same with technology and infrastructure. So if we are developing tools which is, you know, which is hiding you away from the rest of the group, it doesn't really sell, you know, in developing economies. So we've seen that people appropriate these technologies and make them social. There are papers about how there is a phone which allows you to take selfies, and then you see the selfies are being used for group pitches. You know, you stand together and then you take a photo, or you do a online video conferencing, which is for the whole family. It's not used as individual items of use. So I think that's one of the key things for me from her presentation.
So moving, connected to that, Mark, how do you see these fair trade associations? How is that enforceable or encourageable? How do you encourage employers or platforms to start using that?
I mean, maybe the place I'd start is by trying to reiterate the idea that these platforms that we see, they exist they operate at a global scale. The employers act at a global scale, and I think if we want an appropriate response that brings more power into the hands of workers, we need to think of clever global scale responses that make sense and that work. Because at the moment, it's just we have all these atomized workers that are competing against each other in a market, and that's not necessarily good for workers. That's sort of resulting in a race to the bottom. So how do you deal with that? Well, I think we need clever global scale responses. One of the ones you mentioned, which is thinking about, trying to emulate models that have kind of worked in the past. So fair trade has been fairly effective in trying to sort of infuse ideas of ethics into supply chains. If you buy a pen or an iPhone, you know nothing about the nodes of production that are further away from you than the material object in front of you. But if we have organizations that are out there and committed to ensuring that there's transparency in the supply chain, then hopefully that itself, the sort of reattaching of information to the product of the information, so reattaching the information to the service, or reattaching the information to the physical thing, that hopefully can instill some fear in the clients or the bosses or the companies that are at the moment getting away with things that a lot of consumers of these things might find relatively distasteful. So that's the way I'd start with that.
Some of the I'm interested in the lack of transparency with some of these platforms, and it was very interesting hearing about some of the people who use this as a main source of income and the ones that use it as supplemental income. That is that's also a divide, is it, between Global South and Global North. And I was interested in Kristin's map, which seemed to show a clear divide as well with who's implement these 50 countries, Kristin, that you're talking about are Global South, correct? Do you see any crossover in these distinctions between North and South and boundaries disappearing and how the information...
It's mainly, traditionally, it has been a public health system strengthening the Global South, but there's no... I mean, there are many, many Western... I mean, Ukraine is on the map. So many other countries are coming because we see the web technology can actually, be put on top of an integrator, on top of a massive mess of health systems, which is creating a lot of problems. But back to this phenomenon on, I think it will be very difficult to have a kind of a competition of the lowest salary. That can never, I mean, it needs to have some counteractive features coming in, because that's in Norwegian, we call it social dumping. And that will never benefit the worker. It will always benefit the one putting the bid out. So I mean, one way of creating transparency would be to rate your employer. But of course, there will always be others that will, as just, you know, we know, there's always someone that wants to do it lower. So it's actually the whole, I mean, the whole idea of dumping your price on yourself is actually a problematic thing.
But some of these naming and shaming,
naming
the Turkopticon is an interesting model where if it is left to the free market, but you have these apps, is that the right thing to call it, a third-party app that's been created by activists to say, well, here is an employer who's not paying for the work completed, and this was work completed in a timely manner, and warning other Turkers not to accept work from that employer. Can you talk about that? Is that an effective model?
Go for it.
So there is a need for building trust between the worker and, you know, the people who give the work. And we saw that people used Turkopticon in India as a starting point. And they saw that as a very great source of, you know, knowing whether there's somebody there or who's trustworthy. But it was a starting point. So whether somebody's name is on there and they have a 5-star rating, you know, people say that, yeah, okay, this is a great guy, do work for him. Okay, great, but what about somebody who's got a 3-star rating? And is that, you know, totally trustworthy? Is that subjective? And so people still have to go ahead and do a trial and error sort of thing. So they'll do 10 tasks for this guy and see if he pays according to what the reviews are like. So although there is a reputation management system, it's people are still at risk. And so unless there is a way of building accountability within, you know, the work of the requesters and the platform, it's very difficult. I think it'll be very difficult to manage just with such a system alone.
Just to add to that, I agree. It's a useful thing, but it's not enough. And I think one reason, I didn't say this clearly enough in my talk, one reason that it's not enough is because if we see what a lot of these platforms do is they essentially turn work into a commodity. So work's a commodity that can be bought and sold. If work's a commodity and the market for this work is global, and if the market for this work is global and you get people from these 3.5 billion human beings on our planet who are connected to the internet, many of whom are in low-income countries, they're willing to work for extremely low wages. So if work is a commodity, it's almost irrational to take a high price for it and do it yourself. It's more rational to take a high price for it and then re-outsource it yourself off-platform to someone else who can do it. So I think one problem that we're seeing is the very existence of a lot of people willing to do work for a low wage. That is going to act like a magnet, sucking work towards those people and bringing down wages and conditions to the wages and conditions that those workers are willing to work for. And this is only going to get worse as we get our 4th billion person online, our 5th billionth person online.
So with questions of accountability, I was interested in this test case I wanted to ask you both about. I think it was against Crowdflower, where there was a settlement and there were two people named in the lawsuit who were awarded a few $1,000s. But are you aware of this test case? It was interesting to me because it connected these labor platforms to companies like Uber, where you're saying, are they employers? How accountable are they for some of these dubious labor practices? I wonder if there's any recourse in the law. Could you speak to that? And then we think we're going to open up for questions.
I know of the case, but I don't know the law and the economic side of it. I was aware that it brought out questions of how do you quantify being a worker on these platforms. So the questions were out, how many hours are you spending working? What counts as overtime? And do you then become an employee just because you've been working for that platform for X number of hours? The argument to that is Yes, but it's still crowd work, so you're not working for one particular client. You're working for 10 different clients. So how do you account for that? And that was one of the major arguments in the case.
And yet the surveillance mechanisms are much more pronounced than in many traditional work settings. Am I right?
Well, not just surveillance, but also, I think one way in which one way in which platforms have gotten away with classifying workers as sort of freelancers or non-employees is, traditional definitions of this implies that the worker has a lot of control over things like scheduling. But a lot of the workers we speak to have very little control over scheduling. And so they're much more similar to what you might think of as a traditional employee than a freelancer. But I think that's getting into muddy waters, and maybe these traditional definitions of contractor or worker aren't as useful as they could be when we're trying to think about the sorts of work that's being done digitally or digitally mediated on these sorts of platforms. But I think to me at least the most interesting questions about law here relate to the jurisdiction of law, to ask questions about what I mentioned in my talk, which is, should we be sitting here in Oslo, should we be allowed to hire a worker for less than Norwegian minimum wage, no matter where they are? Should we be allowed to hire a worker, even if that worker is in Kenya, without applying Kenyan legal protections to that person? At the moment, all of this is just under the radar.
So therefore, the work relates to the local jurisdiction.
And to figure out where that local jurisdiction is.
Really. So the Fair Standards Labour Act, I have a date on it of 1937, which was obviously not written with crowd work in mind. Some of these laws are not up to date.
Probably.
So let's open up to questions. Professor Sell.
Well, as an immediate problem, if you tell an employer in California that you have to pay California minimum wage to your employees...
If you tell an employer in California that you have to pay California minimum wage $15 an hour to your employees in Bangladesh or Mumbai, then they'll simply stop hiring. The reason those people are hired now is that they have a comparative advantage. They do equal quality work for less pay. Now, so I think there are ways of overcoming the obvious injustice, but to simply insist on a blanket application of a California minimum wage doesn't seem to me effective. It would just put those people out of the market.
So do we have a question that's related to this point? Because then we can ask the panelists to answer in the same area. Anybody else at the back there?
It's more a desperate sigh or something. I mean, I've been living in Indonesia for 2 years, and the cost of life is so different, and the valuta, how do you say, so currency. So I hired Indonesian workers, and I was criticized and ridiculed for giving boss pay to everybody. I was ridiculed for giving them too much, which was something like 4 kroners a day or something, something I couldn't tell here. So it was very impossible. But the way the West has solved this is that we've had minimal pay, because it's always been like that in difficult times, that people will offer their work at something they can't survive on. I mean, desperacy is... So this has been handled historically before, but not on a global level. So this is sort of a question and a desperation and, yeah.
And added to that point, that actually, am I correct in thinking that many of these workers are actually based in the West and working for amounts as low as... $2 an hour. Can you speak to these points?
So the on the American side of Mechanical Turk, yes, there are wages which are less than minimum wage, but workers do not like and they condemn actively working for such requesters. And if you go to Tokopticon, if you go to these forums, and they talk about these requesters and they put their names out there and say, this guy doesn't pay, equal to minimum wage, do not work for him. And if these jobs are taken up then by, you know, Indian workers or international workers, they are condemned as well because they're trying to actively make sure that they maintain a level in income. But it's hard to say what the pay is now on average. There is an online tracker called MTurk Tracker, which monitors the demographics and pay actively. And I guess we'll have to look at that to get more figures.
I mean, I have two ways of responding, a short version and a long version. The short version to the my response to the Californian employer is tough. The long version is I'm not suggesting that we pay everyone in the world who works in an online platform a Californian minimum wage. But at the moment, again, it's very unregulated. In our research, we spoke to plenty of workers who were working 60, 80, 90 hours a week. We spoke to workers who got sick and then don't get paid anymore. We spoke to workers who get pregnant and then don't get paid anymore. We spoke to workers who they work for weeks for someone and then they abscond without paying. What we need are ways of dealing with these sorts of situations and regulating them, essentially, so that it's not a wild west in which an employer can get away with whatever they want to get away with.
No, I think that's right, but the original suggestion that you simply pay California minimum wage, that's tough on the employees, because you won't hire any more people out of California.
No, but what we could do, for instance, is figure out what a living wage is in every jurisdiction on Earth and pay that living wage.
That's an intellectually interesting problem. Yeah. But the blanket idea that you can simply impose a California minimum wage internationally does not seem reasonable.
I don't think anyone's suggesting that.
Yeah.
You have a law in the United States which mandates that American companies operating this online labor service would be legally obliged to pay the minimum wage in all the jurisdictions that they were operating. Is that right? Can you do that?
I think there already exists a law that, for instance, that American companies should not break laws in any country in which they operate, right? And so if you're not adhering to local labor standards, then you're breaking laws in those countries.
Right.
I think that the problem is enforcing these sorts of things, right? But again, you know, it's only a handful of countries where most of this work comes from. If there could be found a way in those countries to ensure that American companies are doing the right things, British companies are doing the right things, then you'd solve a lot of the problem. The work isn't coming from all over the place. It's coming from only a few places.
Colin was first, come on.
Okay.
We need to have some Scandinavian rules.
I had a question have anybody ever sort of done research comparing the historical putting out system, which was before manufacturing industries where you sort of had cottage labor and sort of how factories first improved their lives and then actually made it worse because the putting out system didn't exist as a fallback position for these workers. So the question is, whether anybody had done some historical comparison, because I think there is an interesting link. They are not the same, but they are similar in a sense, because the putting out system had basically one manufacturer who came with a raw material, and the cottage workers had to work on that. So my last question is, I think it's very difficult to improve the conditions of these workers unless you improve the outside option in one way or another. But they have anything to fall back on outside the relationship, then of course nobody could pay them less if they can fall back on something. And that means that they had to be combined in some sense with some social policies. And India, I think, is a good example of that.
Anyone like to comment, or should we also take the question from...
On the second question, I think there needs to be standardization in terms of what
a platform provides and what the workers can do, what they can ask for in terms of whether it's communication, whether it's money, and who deals with the standardization. We need to decide that together, as in the workers, the requesters, the platforms, the national governments and the regulatory bodies. And there is no consensus yet as to who is going to be the authority on this and how do we form guidelines. So the people who are doing research in this space have created an online campaign, and there are guidelines out there for people who want to use the platforms as well as people who are trying to answer these questions. But these are just guidelines from, you know, these sort of conversations that we have. There is still no consensus.
Professor Mark Graham has mentioned about the attitude, something about the attitude of consumers. I don't feel easy when my husband buys films and books by Amazon, knowing that how bad condition their workers are working. These crowd workers exist because there is a market of cheap products. How can we do as consumers to support these crowd workers to improve their situation? Any suggestion?
So, questions about consumer power, and I suppose that links up to this idea of fair, like if you buy coffee that has fair trade on it, and you name and shame a little. Can you speak to this, Kristin?
Just to stress that the beauty of social media is actually that you can create transparency. If you already mentioned it, you know that you can be in shame if you are a bad employer, and so what. What I would think is, I don't think consumers are aware what's going on, because this is a market that is very invisible for consumers. But it's what can be transparent is actually one thing is that people write about it, but another thing is actually to share, as you mentioned, you don't need an app to share rating on employers and share stories about where what to do in order to get a decent salary. But the problem is like we have also a problem in Norway. When people are willing to, I mean, the labor market is difficult, and when people are willing to, I mean, the whole capitalist society is actually going after the most profit, and that's then that kind of rule is will always be difficult for people that then could offer jobs for lower price than others. So there, it's what you have in addition. But, I mean, create more transparency on this, if that's possible, to negotiate with these platform providers. At least they had a rating which platform to avoid. But if that kind of social movements can help out to make those features and make that more transparent, who's actually treating the employees bad and who's not, so you can have this rating and beauty contest, that would be something, because then you can mobilize the workers. And I think that should be kind of a project for, I mean, of course, that need to be sponsored by someone in the beginning, but to mobilize people. And the social media, the beauty of that is that it travels fast if you do something good.
Mm-hmm. Mark?
I think it's a good question. I think a sort of consumption or market-led solution is only ever going to be part of the problem. But I think it can be quite a useful weapon when it comes to terrifying the big companies that sit at the top of the digital production chain, the Googles of the world, the Facebooks of the world. If you highlight enough problematic practices downstream or upstream in the production network, then they'll be scared that they'll lose sales or lose views or lose users for that reason. But again, I think it can only be part of the solution. One thing I would disagree slightly on with Kristin is that I don't think the way to do this is by asking these sorts of firms for their data. I think the way to do this is by essentially taking their data. So what what we're doing, what me and some colleagues are doing, we're building a platform called wikichains.org, and what that is essentially, the goal of it is to be essentially a Wikipedia for commodity chains. We're not asking anyone for that data. It's user-generated. You can add any node about anything, anywhere in the world. And the goal is that we'll slowly be able to piece together information about how things are produced. So if you have information about problematic production practices in a factory somewhere in Vietnam, you can ultimately link that to the shoes that the factory is producing. Mm. So I think doing something like that in tandem with what I mentioned in my talk, a Fair Work Foundation of sorts, we know that the Fair Trade Foundation has done some quite brilliant things over their history. I think we definitely need something equivalent for work, a Fair Work Foundation. If anyone wants to help me build it, get in touch.
And perhaps we should remember that, and correct me if I'm wrong, but most of these hits are simple human intelligence tasks that computers cannot do that we all benefit from on a daily basis numerous times. Is that correct? So if we use Google Maps or and we get the right address that shows up in the pictures, those are all tasks computed by crowd workers, correct?
I was thinking about one of the things you talked about in terms of purpose of a task. We don't know. So when there is a hit posted, the actual purpose of the complete task, we don't know. And the workers don't know. They would like to know what is going on. If it's a task that pays them 10 cents for a few minutes worth of work, the requester doesn't bother giving more information than that because he's already spent a lot of time cutting the bigger task into smaller chunks. And that's why they, although they care about the purpose of the task, they don't really know what is going on, where that work is going to be used. So when they are writing fake reviews, they don't really know. I mean, you can guess after maybe 1,000 times that, yes, you maybe are doing something which is not right. But until you have that knowledge, until you know where your work fits in, it's very difficult for, you know, the users on the ground to actually work out what is going on. Unless there is a single task, like a study which says, oh, we are collecting information about diabetes, so we want to know these things, and could you help us? Which then creates a difference because then they feel that they are contributing to knowledge or, you know, some sort of information. So, yeah, that was...
I think that was said perfectly, but I think what that also results in is it makes it really hard for those workers to upgrade their own position on that value chain. Essentially, they can't become their own boss because they don't understand the network of work that they're embedded into. If you make widgets in a factory, one day maybe you can open your own widget factory because you understand the widget making process. But here we don't understand what the digital widgets are often. Not in all cases, but there are many instances of it.
And the subcontracting probably doesn't help. So we should probably wrap up, maybe just a quick one-sentence summary. We're in Norway. What is the Nordic model solution to some of these issues in a sentence?
Open it up and, you know... make everyone accountable for everything that they do. Make it, you know, transparent, I guess, more.
Transparency.
Yeah.
Regulate.
Transparency, regulation, and...
No, but I was just correct when you said that I meant user-generated content. I didn't think that we will go to the employers and ask for data. They will never give away anything. So provide for transparency and sharing. Mm. I mean, that would be, and of course the fair trade thing would also be. But I think the minimal wage, where legislation should actually be applied where the workers are living, and that couldn't be so difficult, but it's very difficult to regulate, and it's very difficult to force people to do it, because that's the claim, it's virtual and global, and... But a minimal wage where people are living from where, but not all countries have that. Mm. So that's also a big problem. So,
so why not make the platform yourselves? You know, create a socially responsible new brokerage platform for these people.
Yeah, many. There are people doing that. There are people building solutions. But I think that that's the reason why, at least in my talk, I ended with four ways forward, because that's not enough. You can build all the platforms you want, and if you're not engaging in some of these other ways of trying to give workers more power or allow workers to take more power for themselves, then it's not enough. Because if you can build your own platform, you can have it be a cooperative, you can pay the workers fair rates, and if that work is commoditized and that work is easy to re-outsource to other people, you know, you can pay the worker $10 an hour and they'll pay someone $1 an hour and keep $9 for themselves. So we need more clever ways to deal with situations like this, with a commoditized world of work.
Yeah, there are technologies that can force the worker to do the work himself or herself through technology. So you can't outsource. Either you do the work and you get paid, or you can't take part.
You can't share.
There is no limit for user innovation, I will just say.
Well, is that something that could be possible? You put a lock on the hips so you can't share the hips? Is that...
There will be workarounds, then they will gather in the room and share the PC, and there are workarounds.